Hello everyone, welcome to BYJU'S classes for the Hindu analysis of 30th September 2018. Now this day's newspaper, that is Sunday's newspaper, is full of many important news which is important both from the perspective of prelims as well as mains. So without wasting any time, let's start with the first topic for the day. Now this topic I have taken, that is Bengal officials raced against time to save rescued corals, and this is important both for prelims as well as from the perspective of GS1, where we have to look into the changes in critical geographical features. Now first of all, let me look into this topic from the perspective of prelims. Number one, you can see here it is mentioned that the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau has recovered 20 live corals from Kolkata. Which place they have recovered, that has not to be looked. Just remember live corals. Now that's one of the first thing that you have to remember, that corals are also smuggled. Usually people talk about birds, turtles, elephant tusk, rhino horns, etc., but then live corals are also smuggled, though they are very rare. Now live corals are being smuggled, but then where are they found in India? That is a question that has been asked earlier also. Now in this particular case, it is that these corals had come from Thoothukudi coast in Tamil Nadu, that is the part of the Gulf of Mannar landscape. Now remember, that means that Gulf of Mannar is one area where we have the corals, but if you look at the last line there, it's mentioned very clearly which all places do we have them. It is said that only four major coral reefs areas are there in the Indian waters, and they are Andaman, Gulf of Mannar, Lakshadweep and Gulf of Kutch. So guys, remember in which areas do we have coral reef. And then in the last statement only, they are mentioning about three different types of coral reef. You can see the fringing, the atoll and the barrier. Now guys, this three main classification that is being talked was talked by Darwin. If I have to give the photograph of these, it would be like, let's say this is water, so your fringing reef is very close to your seashore. It is like this is your fringing reef. Now when this particular landmass, when this goes down, what happens is this water, this was the water area, this would have come till the last, that is the coast, and now this landmass would have gone down. It would have been like this, below the total sea level, and here this reef would be now somewhere here. So this fringing reef would now have gone and become a barrier reef, and later this barrier reef later could have gone and become an atoll. It would have been, let's say this is the land, this is the water level, and below this you have the atoll. So these are the three major classical reef formations which were talked by Darwin. But then there are other types also which have been spoken by many other scientists like Thomas and etc., where they have talked about different reefs like patch reef, ribbon reef, bank reef, apron reef. There are different reefs. Again, I would request you to look into the coral reefs from the perspective of geography and paper 1. These three reefs at least have an idea about the fringing, the barrier and the atoll, where the fringing reef, also known as the shore reef, is directly, as I showed you in the picture, is attached to the sea shore, and it is in the area of a very narrow shallow channel or the lagoon. The most common type of reef that it is usually around 100 meters wide, whereas if you look at the example of fringing reef, then one of the examples of this would be in the Red Sea, Whereas if you talk about the barrier reef, and guys, the most famous example we all would have studied, it is the Australian Great Barrier Reef. The Australian Great Barrier Reef, where one of the largest such types of example. Now these are usually 30 to 70 meters deep, and they are in the open water, as we can see here in this picture, because the land formation has gone below the water level. And the last one more type, that is atoll. Now these atoll reefs are more or less circular, here you can see, or they might be continuous barrier reef, which have now converted into this, and they extend all the way around the lagoon. Examples of this are in Indian Ocean, like Maldives is there. In fact, entire Maldives is made up of only the atolls. And then there are other examples like the Cook Islands, French Polynesia, Marshall Islands of Micronesia. So there are many different examples of this particular type of reef. Now, apart from coral reefs, in this particular topic, there is something mentioned here. Traffic India, a leading NGO working globally on trade. And according to their statement, you can see they are saying corals are facing threat of climate change and smuggling can be an added threat. So if in prelims ever there is a question, what all is influencing or affecting or threatening the corals, one more added point here would be smuggling. So just to give you an example or idea about the traffic, this is an NGO established 1976 globally, and it's now a very widely respected known global network where research driven and action oriented plans are done in order to bring out conservative solutions to the different problems being faced by the biodiversity in the world. As far as traffic with regards to India is concerned, it came to India in 1991 and has been operating as a part of WWF India. Traffic is working with WWF, at the same time is also working with IUCN. What is IUCN? I'll be talking about it later in another particular topic. And this particular traffic had unfortunately stopped in its work in 2002. It resumed its work again in India from 2006 onwards. And traffic is looking after all these issues which is plaguing the illegal wildlife trade, and their major activity is to work closely with the national and the state government. In this case, you can see that the government has seized them in West Bengal, and where they had originated in Tamil Nadu. So they are working closely with the state governments as well as with the national governments to help study, monitor and influence different actions so that they can curb the illegal wildlife trade. Along with this, there is one more thing that you can see in this, that is the Geological Survey of India. Now, Geological Survey of India, this body was formed in 1916. Guys, even if you forget the years, I'm not that much worried, but do remember that Geological Survey of India comes under the Government of India's Ministry of Environment, Forest and the Climate Change, and thus they are the premier Indian organization as far as the geological research and studies for the promotion of survey, exploration and the research of fauna is concerned in the country. They are looking after all this along with different other organizations as far as the country is concerned. Now, apart from this, you have to remember that in this topic, that how do these live corals are extracted? So that is given here. It's not easy to extract a live coral from its reefs by bare hands. So how do you extract? By hammers, chisel, and this indicates, this particular case, that there is a very strong smuggling network which is leading to this coral smuggling as far as India is concerned. So this all you have to remember. Do study about the coral reefs. That would be the most important takeaway. Second takeaway from this topic would be the areas in which the coral reefs are found in India. Do have an idea about traffic. Do have an idea about the Geological Survey of India. And geography through maps, you should remember Thoothukudi is there in Tamil Nadu. So let's move to the second topic for the day. That is, Indonesian quake tsunami kill hundreds. Now, in this topic, guys, two things that you have to remember. Number one, this tsunami and the earthquake has come in a place called Palu. Exactly which place? In the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. So, for geography, from the perspective of geography, you should remember these two particular places. Apart from this, in this topic from the perspective of mains, because in GS paper 1 they can ask you geophysical phenomena like quakes and earthquake, you should have an idea about tsunami. Now you would have studied it in your geography that tsunami, which comes from the Japanese word, is also seen as a very large seismic sea wave. They bring a huge quantity of water and they do it in a such a small span of time that the people don't have the time to safeguard themselves. For example, in this case, what happened was the people were celebrating a festival on the beach in the city of Palu. And when the waters as high as 6 meters had smashed, and this was followed, or because this event was followed by a 7.5 magnitude earthquake. So there was an earthquake and that led to a tsunami. Because of this earthquake, a huge amount of water was displaced, and this brought this tsunami to this particular place, in this case, that is the Palu. Now, if we talk about how does this whole tsunami operates or how does it happen, we have to understand because of an earthquake, the tectonic plate boundaries, they get disturbed. What is happening is, that is, let's say this is a figure. Here there is a subducting plate and here there is a overriding plate. Now what happens is, because of an earthquake, there is a distortion into this overriding plate, and this goes slightly like this upwards, and whereas this subducting plate, which was always going down, is going down, and this which has gone up, now this overriding plate instead of being here, because it has got overridden, goes a bit further, and because of this, suddenly the water which was here, this takes a massive lift like this. So earlier the water was like this because of the displacement, because this much space has now been taken by the overriding plate. What happens is this water has gone up, and this results that tsunami has started. And now, because this much water has now gone up, it would like to move in the different directions, and this way this water now approaches towards the coast. That's why, guys, you have to remember, in the mid sea the tsunamis usually don't do a lot of disaster. It's only when they are near the sea coast, the energy that has been released by the tsunami waves, they create a huge destruction. Now, all the time, remember, tsunami has a very small amplitude, that is, the wave height offshore is very small, and a very long wavelength, that is, often these are hundreds of kilometers long, whereas normal sea ocean waves, they are around 30 to 40 meters only. So you can imagine how much displacement would be happening in this case. Hundreds of kilometers long wavelength in this case. That's why what happens, again I'm repeating myself, that in the sea, that is, in the sea, it is going unnoticed, but when it reaches the coast, it creates a huge amount of destruction. Again, I would request you to look into both earthquake, look into tsunami from the perspective of paper 1. No need to remember in this case how many people died, though it's an unfortunate incident, but then it will not be asked in that format. Just look it from the perspective of the mechanism of tsunami. That would be a thing that you should be knowing. Let us look at the third topic for the day. Now, I have taken it here only in the paper one, because in paper one we have to study about the cyclones. Now here it is mentioned Arctic observations to predict tropical cyclones. Now guys, we know cyclones are the large scale air masses, and these air masses, they rotate around a strong center of low atmospheric pressure. These are characterized by inward spiraling like this. They are the inward spiraling winds. They rotate in a zone of low pressure, and we have that the largest low pressure systems are near the polar vertices as well as the extratropical cyclones of the largest scale. Now guys, already UPSC has asked earlier the difference between the tropical and the temperate cyclones. So kindly go through the differences between the tropical and the temperate cyclones. Also, in cyclones, you will many a times get to refer many different types of words like hurricane, typhoon. So look into what exactly they mean. So that is something that you should look. Now, always with regards to cyclone, do know about the method or the formation of these cyclones. That is, from the prelims perspective, know the requirements of the cyclone. For example, if let's say a cyclone has to come, one of the most important cyclone's requirement is there should be atmospheric instability. That is the low pressure that we were talking about. Then along with the atmospheric instability, the sea ocean temperature, that should also be sufficiently warm. Along with that, there should be high amount of humidity as far as the middle levels of the troposphere are concerned. Then to make a low sphere or low pressure center, there is requirement of Coriolis force. Apart from this, there has to be a pre-existing low level disturbance, and lastly something called low vertical wild shear. So when you require a tropical cyclone or the cyclone, you should remember these are the six main requirements of cyclone. Now this was in brief about cyclone. Do look at it from the perspective of your mains. Very, very important paper one topic, cyclone. And of course, those who have the geography optionals have to remember it. There have been questions on tropical as well as temperate cyclones and different such things. Now, also remember one of the things that is sometimes, you know, they ask you, like question would be that explain the tropical cyclones and illustrate the different methods through which the destruction brought by them can be reduced. That is some measures that you can suggest, and here one of the measures is there, that is Arctic observations are being set up so that they can predict the tropical cyclones. Now though the heading is mentioning only tropical cyclones, here it's also mentioning both mid-latitude cyclones also, and thus these extreme climate events can be predicted. As you can see here, the words like hurricanes, the typhoons, and they all are being predicted. And because of these weather forecasts, what would happen is that people would be prepared for the weather disasters, and thus this would come down. Now in this case, it has been reported in a study which was done over the North Atlantic and North Pacific during 2016 to predict the path and the intensity of the cyclones. Lastly, you should remember that this data was analyzed using a data assimilation system developed in Japan Agency for Marine Earth Science and Tech, which can produce reanalysis data sets by mixing observations into global atmospheric conditions. So just remember that there is the data of data assimilation system was prepared by a agency in Japan. No need to remember exactly the name and all this about this. So last thing that I would mention here is, do remember about or study about your cyclones, the methods. Always remember, this is the last topic for this particular area, that is, in cases of tsunami or cyclone, whenever you are making or writing an answer in mains, do try to add a picture of that, a rough picture. How does this cyclone or how does this tsunami come will only help you to gain more marks. So that is something that you should always be very careful about. Now let us move to GS paper 2, and in this case the first thing that we are doing here is the Anganwadi worker moves Bombay High Court. Now one of the things here is that this particular case, a lady has challenged the government of Maharashtra, which had dismissed her for having more than two children and not following the ideas of small family. Lady's name has been given, and no need to remember the name, and even for the time being just remember that such a case has come because final ruling hasn't yet come. In this, first of all, there is a scheme mentioned, Integrated Child Development Services, ICDS. Now why I am taking this, because in the GS2 you have to study the government policies. When was ICDS started? 1975, discontinued in 1978 by the ministry of then Prime Minister Mr. Morarji Desai, and later on it was again started. Why was this government program started? It was started to provide some basic things like food, preschool education, then primary health care. And primary health care to whom? To the children under 6 plus their mother. Now this particular Anganwadi scheme was relaunched, as it was called off by the government of Mr. Morarji Desai, during the 10th 5-year plan. Now of course we don't study about 5-year plans, but in economics guys you study about the planning. So remember, the 10th 5-year plan again re-established it, mainly to reconnect it with something called as Anganwadi. Now guys, those who are coming from the Hindi belt would be knowing that Angan is a space in the houses, that is the open courtyard, something like that it is there. And the Anganwadi, they are the workers, that it's Anganwadi is a type of child care center as far as the country is concerned. And when the word worker gets attached to that, then the people are those who are the people who are working amongst these rural areas. So these are the frontline workers who take care of what all? Malnutrition. They take care of the ill health. They are assisting in tackling the gender inequality by providing the same resources what the boys are getting to the girls also. Now guys, we have to understand one of the first things is that this ICDS has been successful in the sense that if you look the infant mortality rate, it has gone down to 44, and the under 5 mortality rate has gone down to 93. Even though now also it is high, but if you look at the historical figures, they have come down. Now under the ICDS scheme, the whole idea is, as I have said, that they look after the education, health, all these services. So one of the first thing under the health they do is immunization. For example, pulse polio, one of the most and the brilliant schemes run by the government of India. At the same time, not only brilliant in thinking about the plan, but also in execution, because polio has been eradicated from our country. Along with this, they also look after the supplementary nutrition. Guys, we have talked about malnutrition. So for this, they look after the nutrition. That is, everyday ICDS for the nutritional purposes provides some 500 kilocalories, that is 12 to 15 grams of protein, to every child below 6 years age. Whereas the girls, for adolescent girls, it is up to 500 calories with around 25 gram of protein every day. Now, which ministry is carrying out? Remember it for pre, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This particular ministry is carrying out this particular plan, and many different world organizations like World Bank is assisting us, then World Health Organization is assisting us, and along with the ICDS, now we also had added from 2008 another plan for the rural care, only National Rural Health Mission, and NRHM was also added, and all these have taken care that these improvements have been done with regards to the deficiencies which are there nutritional, as far as the young children in the rural areas are concerned, or the deficiencies in regards to immunization, or with regards to educational deficiencies. All these are taken care by. Now, this was all about the ICDS scheme. It's an old scheme, but then it is always important from the perspective of any question on health specifically, or malnutrition. That is, let's say there is a question, explain the different measures taken by the state and the central governments to eradicate malnutrition in India. So you will have to give these examples. Now, as far as the Anganwadi worker is concerned, now Anganwadi worker, they come under the Ministry of Women and Child Development, and they have laid down the guidelines for the responsibilities of these particular ladies, now, or the gents. Now, Anganwadi workers, usually around 40 to 65, they are supervised by one Mukhiya Sevika, and they are the first line of workers who come to aid and assist the people who are there in the rural areas, and they cannot reach the skilled professionals. Who are the skilled professionals? In this case, the medical and the healthcare experts. Guys, you have to understand that there is a absence of the best quality of health institutions in our village system. So there, these Anganwadi workers, they, in the absence of the skilled professionals, they try to meet the goals of enhanced health facilities which are affordable as well as accessible. So this all is done. This Anganwadi worker in many ways is also better than a physician, as she is living in the same locality, knowing the cause of the health problems, and hence also knowing the counter or the methods to counter them. So this has been working, though there are different challenges and solutions which you should know. So for that, always remember, you can have a mains question, that is, critically evaluate the Anganwadi concept in India with regards to health. Also bring out their successes, the challenges being faced by them, and in your opinion, what could be the solutions to them. So such a question can be asked in your mains. Last thing, come to this particular case. The case is that this lady had her third child, and under the government rule, she couldn't have more than two child. But what she is saying is that when this rule came in the month of August 2014, she was already pregnant 8 months with her third child. So she is saying that she should be exempted from this 2014 government resolution, which had mandated that state employees in various departments including the ICDS scheme should not have more than two child. So guys, you can see this resolution came in August 2014. She had gone to the court in the next year April, and now this is coming to be heard in the High Court just last week. So one of the things that we can see is the slow justice system that is plaguing our country also. So if you can remember this case, great, no need to remember this lady's name, but then you can cite it as an example also. Let us look at the fourth topic, again related to health but also to polity. The thing is that MCI, Medical Council of India, is being scrapped, and in this case the Indian Medical Association Action Committee is saying or is criticizing this particular aspect, that why are you, you know, ending this particular MCI. So that's the thing. Now first of all, let's look at the history of MCI. MCI established in 1934 under the Indian Medical Council Act 1933. Now it was MCI, and this council was later reconstituted under the Indian Medical Council Act 1956. Now the thing is, why this MCI is being scrapped, and this is something which is in news for a very long period of time, not something very new, because last year in 2017 there was a new bill which was brought in, which is still pending in the parliament. The bill was National Medical Commission or NMC Bill 2017. It was introduced in Lok Sabha by the Health Minister Mr. JP Nadda, and this bill had called for replacement of MCI. Now guys, here always remember, very very important point, MCI is elected by medical practitioners across the country, not the MP that is member of parliament, but medical practitioners across the country, they elect the MCI. And now the government is saying this MCI would be replaced by a 25 member National Medical Commission, and here is the very very particular point, selected by a search committee headed by a cabinet secretary, headed by the cabinet secretary in fact. So guys, one of the things, one of the biggest criticism of this new bill is that you are replacing election with what, the nomination, and this is one of the big big criticism of this particular bill. That is, earlier it was elected, now you are selecting him by a search committee, of course headed by the cabinet secretary. Now here in this new bill, it is said that the chairperson and the members, whoever would be, they all would have a 4-year tenure. They would be going ahead with a 4-year tenure, and there would be a national licentiate examination for MBBS graduates within 3 years of the bills getting passed by the parliament. Another very important, that is national licentiate exam for the MBBS graduates would be happening within 3 years from the time this bill is passed. So what will this new body do, or this particular exam will do? They will grant a license for medical practice, and they would look into the admission for all the PG course. Now here comes the important thing, that is guys, this body will look after all those doctors and who have done the MBBS, and now if they are going for the postgraduate courses. Now here you have to understand that this bill is talking about the practitioners of homeopathy also. They are also talking about the allopathic medicine. That is, here they are saying that the homeopathic doctors and the Indian systems of medicine, that the other systems like, let's say, Yunani, Siddha, they will also be allowed to prescribe allopathic medicine after completion of a bridge course. Now guys, this is the second big criticism of this particular act. That is, why are you doing this? That is, how can you just ask a homeopathic doctor to do a bridge course and then start giving the allopathic medicines? So this is also a very big thing, very big change is happening. Another important point under the NMC would be that medical colleges will need permission only once for the establishment and recognition, and they would not need to pay any annual renewal. So what will happen is they will not be paying every year, and these people will now be able to decide how much seats they want to have in their college on their own, subject to maximum number of seats being 250. Apart from that, they are also saying that these people would be given the rights to also do the postgraduate courses. But then the fine is also steep this time. They are saying that if there is any violation, there would be fine of almost 1.5 into 10 times the total annual fees charged. So that's the thing that will happen in future. So now, what's the need? Why has this been in news? Why is this Medical Council of India being replaced? Now guys, this is not something new. MCI was under a lot of controversy for a very long period of time, specifically in 2010, when the then MCI's president, Mr. Ketan Desai, had been arrested by CBI for accepting money, and under the Prevention of Corruption Act, they had recovered a large amount of money from his place. And also MCI was criticized for a lot of malpractices which were happening in the health sector. That was one of the things which started all this. Along with this, the 92nd report of the Parliamentary Standing Committee for Health and Family Welfare had examined the MCI's functioning, and they had taken out or pointed out the problems that were being faced by this body. The problems including failure to produce doctors, including specialist and super specialist, shortage of teachers in medical colleges, poor regulations for undergraduate and postgraduate medical education, corruption, which we have already talked in, opacity as to how these regulators were functioning. There was complete lack of accountability, as well as there was complete failure to discharge the mandated responsibilities. And last but not the least, we all know the huge capitation fees. That is, at the time of admission, the fees that were being taken in violation of the laws by the private medical colleges. And this all led the standing committee to suggest that the MCI has not been up to the mark, and there was a need to have the check and balance mechanism. And for that, they brought this new bill. The government brought this new bill. So why is IMA opposing it? One of the reasons for opposing it, I have already said, is the thing that now instead of election, there would be selection. Another, I have already said the word, that is this bridge course, also known as crosspathy. That is, you are crossing one, that is, let's say it is homeopathy, he is crossing and he is now going into allopathy. And according to present rules, it is completely disallowed. But then if government has its way, they will go ahead and give the Ayush practitioners the power to give the medicines under allopathy also. So the IMA is saying that our goal is to look after the interest of the doctors as well as the community, that is our people at large. So they are saying by having nominations and not elections, this would be undermining the whole process. At the same time, they are saying the licentiate examinations, about which we have already talked here, they are saying this would be creating additional burden for the backward communities. That is, the students from backward communities, they will not be able to clear this. That is another third criticism of this, which they are saying. Fourth that they are criticizing here is that this is devoid of any federal character. This is non-representative, half non-medical body, and will not represent the medical profession of India in any manner, and thus will not work for its affordable health care, because here the appointments will happen. And what they are saying is that many a times these appointments would be because of the political ideologies, and this will undermine the health policies as far as our country is concerned. So these are the things which they are saying. Last but not the least, guys, remember, it's not that this is the first attempt. The UPA previous government had also brought the National Commission for Human Resources for Health Bill 2011 to replace the earlier bills like the Indian Medical Council Act 1956, about which we talked. Then the Dentist Act 1948, the Indian Nursing Council Act 47. So many such acts they were trying to replace. At the same time, the committee of the parliament in 2012 also had asked for many of the changes. So such things keep on happening. From your perspective, for paper 2, always be prepared for a mains answer on MCI, and always be prepared for any question on this. So if you look at this particular article, we have already talked about this particular bill which would be replaced here, and this is a 7-member board of governors led by Niti Aayog member Mr. VK Kaul. He is leading this particular committee, through which has been created through an ordinance just last week. And as you can see, IMA is saying it is unacceptable. Just go through the different reasons that they have said, and this all is being talked here. So let's move to the next topic. Now guys, nothing important in this particular news item. I'm not asking you to remember this. I'm only saying, because in paper 2 we have development processes and development industry, so let's have small idea about what exactly is PTI. The largest news agency as far as India is concerned, having headquarters in New Delhi, and it's a non-profit cooperative which is having around 500 Indian newspapers and has more than 1,000 employees. They are working around 1,000 employees with more than 500 newspapers, and they provide the information and coverage both in English plus Hindi. So this is more than enough about them. Established, if you want to remember, you can remember, 27th August 1947. So this is the news media outlet, the largest news agency that we are talking about. N. Ravi has been elected the chairperson. Not important from prelims perspective, except for these background information about PTI. Let's move to the next news item. Now guys, this is a scheme which has been rolled out in Tamil Nadu. I have taken it from the local pages of Tamil Nadu. Now you just have to remember the scheme's name. What is the name? Poshan Abhiyan. What is the scheme for? To address the malnutrition amongst children, adolescent girls and women. And presently it is there in 11 districts, and it would be carried out in the rest 21 districts too. Earlier was known as National Nutrition Mission, and now it is going to be known as the Poshan Abhiyan. Now, along with these two, that is, how will they tackle the malnutrition? They will be focusing on the first 1,000 days of the child, including the 9 months of the pregnancy, 6 months of exclusive breastfeeding, and then the period of 6 months to 2 years. So just remember the scheme's name. If there is any question on malnutrition, we have already seen one topic before. Do add this also there only under your notes of malnutrition. Look at what all things they are focusing on, and you can see there are other schemes also, that is, different schemes have been converged which all schemes? Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, Scheme for Adolescent Girls, Janani Suraksha Yojana, National Health Mission, Swachh Bharat Mission, Public Distribution System. All these have the common goals and they have been converged, and they are looking after to tackle the malnutrition in children, adolescent girls and women. So just remember about this particular scheme's name, that would be more than sufficient in this case. Now next, this is a very big topic of today's newspaper, that is, it is talking about the labor pains, that is, it's talking about something regarding trade unions, it is talking about what all the problems the labor industry, the workers are having in especially one area of the country, and this area in this case is in Tamil Nadu, as it is mentioned, Chengalpattu Oragadam belt. Now guys, in geography also you have studied the industries chapter, there we study that one of the industrial clusters is in Tamil Nadu, the belt around Coimbatore and all those areas. Important thing about this particular belt is that it is also known as Detroit of Asia. In the first paragraph only it is mentioned. Now guys, I'm sorry for this font being smaller, but I couldn't adjust the whole thing. So just look it in your paper and then you can understand. I'm just picking a few important things. This is a whole big article. You should go through this labor pain, this article, because these people who are working in this belt, which is known as Detroit of Asia, there are companies like Ford, Hyundai, BMW, Daimler, Renault, Nissan. All these companies are having their industries here or factories here, and their capacity is every 20 second they are bringing one car. And you can just imagine how big this belt could be. And in the last few weeks, especially in Yamaha and Royal Enfield, trouble is happening with regards to the labor problems. Also some auto component firms are having issues, and these people are on some sort of strike. One of the biggest reason why they are doing the strike is they are saying that the companies are reaping the maximum profits out of their investment, but they are not upholding the right of the workers. What are the rights of the workers that these people are talking? Now guys, what they are saying is that the companies, they are not allowing them to form unions. That is one of the first thing that they are talking. Now here only let's look at something called trade union, because why I'm talking about trade union, because it is a topic of history also. I think 2017 the question on trade unions have already been asked. Guys, the first trade union, the name also had come in 2017 was virtually started by a man named N.M. Lokhande. This was the first association of Indian workers, and the name was Bombay Mill Hands Association, started in 1890. Later we had many unions, and the first registered trade union was the Madras Labour Union in 1918, founded by B.P. Wadia. Guys, those who would have studied the chapter Home Rule League, there the name B.P. Wadia has come, because he was a very close confidant and very close associate of Annie Besant, and he was working with her. So B.P. Wadia's name you can study over there. Now later the first trade union federation to be set up was ITAC, All India Trade Union Congress, in 1920. Now we all know many of these things have led to the different types of Factories Act coming in that era also. That is, the first act, Factories Act, had come around 1881 by the British government. Later they brought another Factory Act after the independence also. Factories Act came, different Factories Act have come, and from independence till the periods of 1991, that is liberalization, different bodies, the trade union bodies, have been formed in our country. The different names, like first we mentioned All India Trade Union Congress, which is aligned with CPI. Then we have All India Central Council of Trade Unions, that is AICCTU. This is with CPI ML. Then we have the Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, which is with Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. Then we have the Hind Mazdoor Sabha. Then we have the body INTAC, the body which is associated with Indian National Congress. Then there are so many trade unions all over the country. And the largest around 2007 was INTAC, that is Indian National Trade Union Congress, was the largest union in terms of absolute numbers in till 2007. But after that, now it is said that Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh is the largest trade union federation with around 6.2 million people associated with them. So this is about trade unions. Do have an idea about them. Now, if you look at one of the things that they are saying is they were not allowed to form trade unions. So this is the thing. Apart from this, guys, you should also, when it comes to trade union or the labor unrest, always remember the example of Gurgaon, where a few years ago one of the HR employee, HR manager in fact, was burnt in the protest that was done here by the workers. Now in this case, the first thing that I have said here is that the companies are shying away from allowing them to have the union. They are not recognizing the unions. Rather, they are comfortable more with what? A works committee. The mention here, it's mentioned. They are more concerned with the works body. That is the very first body constituted for the purpose of negotiation and settlement between the employer and the workmen is the works committee. And the works committee is required to be constituted in these industrial establishments having 100 workmen. So work committee is being allowed, but not the unions. Now the work committee, it is having both the employer as well as workmen, that is whether it is a unionized or the non-unionized workmen, the representative of everybody is there in the works committee. Now the problem here is that there is no law at the national level which may lead to recognition of the trade unions. And as the experts are pointing out, that just because a trade union has been registered doesn't mean that it would be given recognition later on by the employer, because there might be different state specific laws also. And because of these law not being clear about the recognition of the unions, what is happening is that these people are failing with regards to the bargaining power as far as the workers are concerned. So now what is happening is, you have to understand that the skilled and the educated workforce is mainly done or given the job on the basis of permanent basis. Whereas those who are less skilled, what happens with them is they are put as trainees or as the temporary workers. Along with this, what is happening is that many a time these people are also not getting the minimum wages. That is, large number of trainees or the contract workmen, they just get the statutory minimum wage even after being engaged for long years. Because you can understand, let's say if I'm working in this organization for 5 years, so what my salary was in this year, I would expect a hike here, then next year something, a hike should be there. But in the case of contractual workers and all this, the minimum wage that's been prescribed by the government is carried out in all these years. And that is another big point that these people are bringing. What they are saying, that the unskilled jobs which have no value addition are carried out by the contract workmen. So there they don't get the permanent workers, and the management is not fulfilling the aspirations of the permanent workers also with regards to the aspiration for the fair wages. That is, the trainee and the contract workmen, they are being absorbed, and thus what is happening is that the permanent workmen, their numbers are also coming down. So these are certain issues. Kindly go through this whole thing. If you can remember this particular chart, no need to remember exact numbers, but you can see that Andhra is just around 233, whereas if you look at Tamil Nadu, it is around 241, and this I'm talking about the wage per day for a skilled laborer. This is, if you look at Madhya Pradesh, it is 312. Haryana is around 368. Maharashtra 312. Karnataka 314. So if you look at the major states of India, Tamil Nadu and Andhra, they are less than 250, whereas all these are more than 300 that we are talking. So very clearly, these people are having a very low wage. And finally, what is happening is this low wage and the strikes that are being done here is leading to the impact on the investment, because already the state's industrial climate, that is with regards to Tamil Nadu, has suffered. With regards to, you all would have studied the earlier protest against the Sterlite plant, then the protest over the Chennai Salem Green Corridor, then the IPL matches being removed from Chennai to other states, whereas the neighboring states like Andhra and Telangana, they are very aggressively wooing of these people. And if you look at here only, when Andhra is giving less than 8 rupees, many a times what would happen is the companies would be attracted towards these areas, that is Andhra and all, and move towards that. So this is something that has to be taken care, and all the stakeholders here have to look into this and try to save the situation. Move to the next topic, that is GS2IR. Now guys, this is something that we'll see later again, because Mr. Putin is coming to India, and when he comes, what all things happen between India and Russia, we will be studying that. For the time being, just know India has decided to give 3 MiG-21 flight fighter jets to Russia. Now MiG-21 in Russia has already been stopped, and they have only an emotional value for Russians, because MiGs were the most produced supersonic fighters in the history. Around 11,500 such aircrafts were built and are being operated by 50 countries. Product of Soviet Union, designed under Mikoyan Govich Design Bureau in 50s, first flight 56, entered service 59, Russia stopped producing them in 85. India is still using them, and not one, not two, but 120 MiG-21 is in service, and they would be phased out by 2021-22. So our ministry, our government has decided to give them 3 MiG-21s, just showing a symbolic gesture to show our all weather friendship and our deep strategic partnership between the two countries. Remember this, it will help as a point between Indo-Russia relations. Now, nothing to talk about here, but you can see yesterday our foreign minister, Madam Sushma Swaraj, in UN, while giving her UN General Assembly address, has blasted Pakistan and has shown its duplicity when it comes to the terrorism. She has very clearly outlined that the country which had harbored Osama bin Laden, who was the chief architect and ideologue of 9/11, and at the same time claims to be America's friend as well as ally. I remember the thing that is Hillary Clinton had also earlier stated, that Pakistan, by keeping the terrorist in their backyard, cannot expect that they only bite the neighbors, they will come back biting them also. So Pakistan also now is getting affected because of the terrorism that it was sheltering and it has been harboring. Not only this, Madam Sushma Swaraj very rightly points out that the 26/11 mastermind Hafiz Saeed is still roaming in the streets of Pakistan with impunity. Now guys, you all know that in the recently conducted elections of Pakistan, 25th July, Hafiz Saeed along had formed a political party, had gone into the elections, though did not get any seats. But then he is a designated terrorist. UN has designated him a terrorist, and still Pakistan is harboring and keeping them in protection. At the same time, now Pakistan is also making people who are terrorists and branding them as freedom fighters. Recently, a week ago, Burhan Wani's stamps were brought out in Pakistan and he was shown and characterized as a freedom fighter. So, Madam has clearly outlined all these three things. So, whenever there is a question on Indo-Pak and when you are writing in under the question that is point of terrorism, why is India not talking to Pakistan? We are saying you stop terrorism and then have the talks. Both terrorism and talks cannot happen. You need to stop it and then only we will continue with the talks. And why they are not doing and how they are still continuing, these are the examples. That is, the words and the deeds of Pakistan is not the same. And she has rightly criticized Pakistan, teared Pakistan in the UN General Assembly yesterday. So, in the Indo-Pak relations, do remember this thing. Moving ahead, in the GS2IR only, guys, this is not a topic that I am dealing. I am just showing it over here. What is happening is, we all would have studied the Belt and Road Initiative. Now, Belt and Road Initiative, those who have not studied, kindly go through this. This is a very important initiative of Chinese government, or also known as the Silk Road Economic Belt. Under this, this was established or started in around 2013 by the Chinese President Xi Jinping, and this is talking about interconnecting the infrastructural corridors across the world, different parts. Presently, this particular belt is operating in Europe and in Africa. That is the six corridors that they have got, or they have established, or they are thinking about, is in different areas of Asia, Europe and Africa. And they, under this, they have already built a lot of things. Like in Pakistan, we all know the CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, where the Chinese government has invested more than $60 billion of money. They are talking about this. Then apart from this, they have gone into Iran. They have already built railway lines through that. They are going into the neighboring states like Kazakhstan and all. So all this is there. But then, guys, remember, those who have studied, they would be knowing that already many of these CPEC projects are proving to be very big problems. That is, it can be like an ostrich around the neck of these countries, like in the case of Sri Lanka. The countries now are under huge debt because, in example of Sri Lanka, they created the port, they have the airport, but who is going to use it? They don't have the people. But then debt is already there, which has to be paid back to China. So China has invested a lot of money in this areas. Even today, there was an article in Pakistan that Pakistan is also now getting worried because of these big amounts of investment that the Belt and Road initiatives are doing, because how will you pay them? So these are different concerns about the BRI. Those who have not studied, please look into the different areas. As I said, Africa, Kenya, Ethiopia have got the projects. Europe has got the projects. Asia has got the projects in Pakistan, Malaysia, different countries. But then many of the places, the people have now started to protest against this. For example, giving another example, Malaysia, the recently elected Prime Minister Mahathir Mohamad has cancelled the China funded projects. So different areas this is happening. Looking at this topic is only talking that because the Chinese people are operating in many different countries across the world, what is happening is, at many times they are being threatened, at times being kidnapped, and this has given rise to a huge private security firms in the country, that is in China only. So the topic is not that important. Just remember that this Belt and Road Initiative also has got one more issue. That issue is in the form of that the Chinese workers who are working in different countries, for example, here you can see Sudan, there were 29 workers were kidnapped, and they had to be rescued. And this rescuing is being done by the private security firms which are mushrooming all over the China. So this is all about that. If you will go through, look at one or two examples from this particular article. Moving ahead, GS2IR, there is one more thing, not very great for us, but then reports are that illegal Indian immigration into US has been on the rise. Now guys, Indian migrants who are going, now let's say I am there in US and I had gone there on a student visa. I have completed my studies and now my visa has expired, let's say in 2018. I should now go back to my own country, that is India. But what I did, I started living there illegally. So what happened? I am now an illegal Indian migrant in US. Let's suppose that I came, I was living illegally, I got married also in US only, and tomorrow I have a son, and who then goes to apply for a university. But the problem there is that when he is going for the university seat, he is not getting that. Why is he not getting that? Because he was the son of an illegal migrant and who had already overstayed his visa. So now the son also is an illegal migrant. So now what is happening is my next generation also has become illegal migrant, because in US everybody gets a 9-digit social security number, and this is given only to the US citizens and the permanent residents. Without this number, you are always going to be a illegal migrant. Now because of this, for generations people are getting illegally living over there. Now apart from this, what is happening also is because people think that they have to go to US to make their life better and all, they are going or entering America in the form of illegal groups also. And according to 2018, the number of Indians who have been arrested has already got tripled. How much the people pay? Usually around this much for one entry, and they are crossing through which border? Remember, this is the border which Mr. Trump wants to build a great wall of USA so that nobody comes this side. Now illegally crossing the US-Mexico border and are claiming asylum for persecution. So this all is happening, and this is something that you can mention under the Indo-US relation if there ever a question on this is asked. No need to remember the exact figure, but then this you can remember. Apart from this, you can see the last line, which all areas, Mexicans, Guatemalans, Honduras citizens and Salvadorians, they are the people who have been entering into US illegally. And we all know presently US has not got a very good attitude as far as the migrants are concerned. With Trump coming and becoming the president and he referring to all these residents and trying to send them back, already the life of these people is not that good. And in this number, when this illegal immigrants getting to such a high number, is not going to help our people. And we are seeing in so many cases where the hate crimes have risen. One of the examples being the example of the Andhra Pradesh techie, Mr. Srinivas Kuchibohtala, who was killed, who was shot dead in USO, though he was not an illegal immigrant. He was totally working there on the legal papers. But then the hate crimes are increasing and all this is happening. So let's move into the other example topic. Now guys, for defense, just for pre-remember this aircraft, FTC-2000G, if there is a question what exactly it is a multi-role combat aircraft built by which country? Of course, China. So do remember it for pre-remember. From here onwards, we'll be looking at many topics which are for pre. This is defense. If there is ever a pre question, just for one line, you have to remember. Now, today's newspaper is full of many topics on health. That is, you can see one of the topics here being dementia. Then another article here in today's newspaper is about the fecal transplants help antibiotic therapy. The third article is about the demystifying science, where the talk is about open insulin project. Fourth is cocoa butter a source of vitamin D. Fifth, AIMS study finds 23% prevalence of hypertension amongst the rural school children. Sixth, the mechanism of colistine resistance in Klebsiella bacteria unraveled. Along with this six news item, there are items on biodiversity, that is the seizure of black spotted turtles, then adamant algae, death by plastic, then mighty mephube, IUCN threat categories, phosphorus from space, another science topic, a cool solution, and then three topics on culture, that is Taj, Mughal era bridge to live on, Idlewing team inspects big temple, and lastly railways and the Google. So what we shall be doing is the rest of the topics, which are the smaller topics which are left for the day, we shall be looking at them in the next lecture. That is, we'll be completing these all 14 topics, the part 2 of today's newspaper, tomorrow, because already it is a huge thing that we have done for today, and the rest of the things we shall be doing tomorrow. Kindly subscribe to the channel, like the video. That's all for the day. Thank you. Goodbye.